Well, we are now into the album mode, and I am a double bio dude this week.
Yep.
So I am going to be starting with a return to jazz, and in particular, some free jazz. And something we haven't done yet, guys, jazz guitar.
Yeah, I know.
I know, are you ready? Are you ready for like a new lane that probably we haven't, right? Like
No,
I'm
definitely
gonna, don't
not.
worry, Matt, I'm gonna give you the songs I'm doing in a second. But yeah, it is definitely a new lane. I was a little bit caught off guard from it, but we are covering Sonny Chirac, Ask the Ages from 1991. And in the beginner, I know that I picked Many Mansions and Who Does She Hope to Be. Can you remind me, Josh, what I put in the montage? Was it, I think it was Many Mansions.
Let's see, montage. What does she hope to be? And then
Okay.
opening is Many Mansions.
I reversed it. So now you're going to hear Many Mansions. Okay, so Sonny Chirac, our first jazz album of the 80s, we covered quite, or excuse me, the 90s. We covered quite a few in the 60s. We covered some in the beginning of the 70s, and we were relatively jazz-free in the 80s. So I
Yeah,
did
jazz
want to
went
bring.
away. It didn't exist in the 80s, really, is what happened.
I did want to, though, have a representative couple jazz albums in here, and this one was highly regarded. So let's talk about Sonny Chirac. He was born in, I'm hoping you might be able to help me, Matt, although it's a different part of New York than you. It's in that Westchester County area. Ossining, New York.
Yeah,
Ossining.
Ossining, up the Hudson.
Oh, so you are familiar, Josh.
Only because I believe Don Draper lived there in Mad Men.
There we go. So he is, so Sonny Chirac is in the Ossining High School Hall of Fame, by the
Oh,
way,
wow.
posthumously. So that's that. Yes. So he did eventually move to New York City, but he spent at least up until 20 in Ossining, New York. So good catch there, Josh, helping us out. He was born in 1940. Unfortunately, he did pass away at 1994 at the age of 54 of a heart attack, as he was in the, not exactly when he was doing it, but he was in the process of signing a deal for his first major label
Oh,
record contract.
jeez.
So his wife was a singer, and sadly, it did not come to fruition. So this is actually the last studio album that he ever released. In terms of studio albums, I count 11 studio albums and one live album, and a lot of compilations and posthumous stuff as well. But that seems to be the while he was alive body of work. Now that is just the stuff with him. He was bouncing around in some big groups along the way. I will say though that his style is free jazz and avant-garde jazz. And you know what, Matt? I just realized that I did not ask you for the numbers. So we'll wedge it in right here. What are the
Oh,
numbers? Yeah.
so Ask the Ages by Sonny Chirac comes in at 647 in the 1990s on Best Ever Albums, number 54 in 1991, number 3,746 of all time. It is Sonny Chirac's second highest rated album on Best Ever Albums behind 1969's Black Woman. This album did not make Rolling Stone's list, and Sonny Chirac comes in at number 1,497 in overall artist rankings on Best Ever Albums.
Okay, so thanks for putting that in context. Some interesting stuff about Sonny Chirac. His primary instrument, as we said, is the guitar. He actually started his singing career being a part of a vocal group. He was singing there. He took up the guitar at 20, so relatively later than the average one. And some of the reason he did was he was influenced by the album Kind of Blue by Miles Davis, which we did cover back in the 60s. So he was playing there. And he is considered to be one of the innovators of what's called the free playing style. And the free playing style on guitar for him was based on what John Coltrane, Albert Ayler, and Pharoah Sanders did on the saxophone, and actually was a little bit influential on Jimi Hendrix as well. He was a member, he made his recording debut actually on Talid, Tauhid, by Pharoah Sanders, and he was actually in Pharoah Sanders' band from 1966 to 1968. We did cover Pharoah Sanders way back when, in the 60s, and interestingly enough, we will also cover him in the 2010s, way down the road. So he will be making an appearance considerably later. Maybe the largest gap between a two album artist in the entire time we'll do Combing the Stacks, God willing that we're still doing the podcast then. He leaves Pharoah Sanders' group on good terms to join Hubie Mann's group, and Hubie Mann was a flautist, so it was an inter. I did listen to a little bit of their work to hear. His frenzied guitar playing was sort of juxtaposed with the flute playing of Mann, and that kind of created the sound of what was the sound of that group. He was doing some other session work. Toward the end of the late 60s, he released his first two solo albums, of which Matt mentioned. One of them was Black Woman, which, along with this album that we're covering today, is considered to be one of his two seminal works. He turned down an audition with Miles Davis in 1970, but he did do a solo, uncredited, on a tribute to Jack Johnson. So it wasn't so much that Miles Davis wasn't willing to give him credit. He just sort of wanted to go his own way, at least as I read it. And then he kind of floated around a little bit in obscurity. Some people said it was because he had chances to be more commercial, but he kind of leaned into the more commercial lane. Jazz kind of fell off of the commercial forefront sort of when he was in his peak years. But he did have a comeback in 1986. He joined a jazz supergroup known as Last Exit, and released some albums that sort of veered into all kinds of different styles, including one that had a metal tinge. I had to listen to a little bit of that. And there is, you can hear a little bit of the metal, but he was sort of experimenting. And this was considered to be an accessible work that sort of was moving him into the stereo systems of both jazz listeners, especially the ones in the 60s and 70s who embraced the avant-garde jazz. I mean, I don't think he's ever going to get the traditionalists, but it was right up their lane. And he was starting to get a little bit of cool appeal, right, with music writers and stuff like that as well, that was going to lead to that album deal. But unfortunately, he did pass away from a heart attack pretty suddenly. The last thing that he ever recorded, he and his drummer recorded music, including the theme song for Space Ghost Coast to Coast, was the last work that he ever did shortly before he passed. So if you want to hear the last work of, I mean, probably not the most represented, but the last work of Sonny Chirac, you can listen to some of the music from the early seasons of Space Ghost Coast to Coast, as well as the theme song.
His
So,
crowning achievement, I'm sure.
not as crowning achievement, but something that I thought would be interesting. So, yeah, I'm going to kind of leave it there. Matt, what'd you think of this one?
Yeah, I like this one. This was a I'd never heard this guy before. Never heard, after listening to it the first time, I was like, so I wasn't even sure he was the guitarist. That was I was like, what? I wasn't sure what instrument he played. And I think this is kind of like Miles Davis was always interesting to me when I first started learning a little bit about more of the history of jazz, because just the idea of the electro plugging in, like, kind of going, taking things in a different direction, electronic jazz, just that concept in and of itself was appealing to me. And I always found stuff, even though I liked some of that stuff that Miles Davis did, I found that Bitches Brew was like, there was a lot of, there was a, that was a heavy album to get through. It was kind of like a lot more like homework. And it just didn't really connect with me as much. This is kind of something that I feel like is it does connect with me with that with an, more of an electronic sound, certainly with the electronic electric guitar being played here. There are free jazz elements, and particularly I think early on in the first track, Promises Kept, there's a saxophone part that's just really like this manic, like
Just goes
panicky, like
and that's Pharoah Sanders. We didn't
That's
say that.
That's Pharoah
on this
Sanders.
album.
There you go.
That is
Thank you.
Pharoah Sanders. Yes,
Wow.
he is the complimentary part of this. I apologize for not sharing that yet.
Yeah. So that might have been the only part of this record that I ever remember like hearing that I was like, oh man, I want like there was an urge to skip that part, right? Like I don't like that. I don't need that. But it's relatively short-lived. It doesn't, it's just kind of one part of this one song. It's not like a it's a prominent feature throughout the rest of the record. And so and once I realized that, and then I would listen to it the second or third time, it didn't nearly bother me as much as it did that first time. So But there are other times throughout this that, yes, that free jazz, you know, format kind of comes about. There's some discordant, you know, things happening here. There are things that are, you know, notes that are being played that don't seem like they fit in. There's beats that are kind of, sounds like at times that the different musicians are kind of just, everybody's doing their own thing and then they just put it all together. So sometimes it's hard to find like where the cohesion kind of comes in. But I don't think it's something that really lasts a long time. I think that for the most part, it does, they do kind of congeal and create a really interesting sound, which, you know, I particularly liked a song like, you know, who did, like the songs that you picked, John, Who Does She Hope to Be and Many Mansions. There's like this, there is this repeating chord progression that kind of keeps the song grounded throughout the 8 or 9 minutes, however long it is. And then on top of that, that's when you're getting more of the freestyle improvisation. So it was an interesting thing because I was thinking about the Eric Dolphy album that we did light years ago. And how that was just a really hard record for me to...
Out to Lunch for those.
Yeah, Out to Lunch by Eric Dolphy was a hard record for me to get down to. But I think one of the reasons, and I didn't listen to that, I didn't go back to compare it this week, but if I were to guess, I would say that record was kind of lacking in some of the more foundational elements that are happening in some of these songs here that kind of ground the song for me anyway. Yeah. So it made it easier for me to once I had that pattern, I was like, okay, and then I could let the rest of the song be what it was. So it's hard for me to say this definitively because it's been so long since we've covered jazz albums, but I can just go by what my feeling is listening to this. And this is to me one of the more pleasurable jazz albums that we've listened to. I would put this probably towards the top. I definitely like Kind of Blue by Miles Davis. Well, we didn't cover Kind of Blue, but that's an album that I would put this up there with, as well as the Miles Davis album that I really liked. The electronic one was the one that was right before Bitches Brew, which was In a Silent Way. That was the one that I kind of gravitated more towards. So yeah, I really like this. There's elements of this record that I think are really good, kind of relaxing, kind of like evening, like, you know, there's like more of a laid back vibe. And then there's other songs that are more like upbeat and kind of like, you know, get your attention. It's a little bit more alert. So it kind of ebbs and flows pretty well. And I just like the vibe. So I'm a thumbs up on this.
Yeah, I'm a thumbs up too. It's wild to think that he was around in the 60s when we were talking about other jazz artists at that time. And he was probably one stop over from many of the artists that we talked about. And I'm a big fan of this album too. I think the thing, it's just wild to hear like the electric guitar in a jazz context. And I think that since we're so used to the electric guitar, at least I am, that kind of like allowed me entry into this easier. And I feel like a lot of the things that are done with electric guitar correlate to what I hear on this jazz album. I mean, people all the time do like crazy guitar solos on an electric guitar, and I feel like that's here. But I don't know, it just, the album as a whole felt very easy, accessible, as John pointed out, and there are those chords or repeating parts that play throughout multiple songs, different parts obviously, or at least play at the beginning and the end, kind of tie the song together. It's funny you mentioned Hendrix, John, because I feel like Hendrix would have really liked this type of music, and if he had lived long enough, he might have like gone in this direction at some point, or like been away from rock and roll and gone more avant-garde or something. I just kind of picture that.
I heard bits of Band of Gypsies, which we didn't cover, that album, and even a little bit of Axis Bold as Love, you know, in this for sure.
I also really, this is like an instrumental album. There is no singing on it. The other thing I really appreciate is how everyone gets a solo or a chance to shine on the different tracks. There's a bass solo on Promises Kept, the first one. You got the sax with Pharoah Sanders. He makes multiple sax appearances or solos throughout. And there's just kind of this crazy, and the drums too. Everybody is just at the top of their game, and you can hear that, you know, by the way that they weave together and the solos as well. Once Upon a Time has a crazy drum solo that starts and then the bass comes in, and then finally the guitar. That's the last track on the album. But overall, I just really kind of enjoyed it. It had this a lot of the avant-garde jazz doesn't seem to kind of like carry a steady beat throughout, where I feel like all these songs kind of had something that tied me to it and kept the rhythm, and I was able to follow along while they deviated off in these different directions, and that just made it really enjoyable. And I liked kind of hearing this interpretation of the electric guitar and its use in a jazz context. So I will mention that the last jazz album I did like was that Herbie Hancock album that we did, Headhunters, mm-hmm. back in the 70s. That was really good.
Oh yeah, that was good. Yep.
So a thumbs up though. I'm glad jazz has made a return. It was kind of a refreshing change of pace.
Yeah, well, I was higher on some of the free jazz we did in the 60s, I think, than you guys were.
Yeah.
Like, mm-hmm. And I think I made the comment that I thought like Out to Lunch by Eric Dolphy almost was kind of like a punk album in jazz format. So imagine my surprise when I saw that Sonny Chirac in this era was considered punk jazz. I was like, well, apparently there is a thing. There's something to what I was saying before. And unlike you, Matt, who did not enjoy that frantic nature of the sax in Promises Kept, I loved it because I thought it set the tone, like an urgency and immediacy, a rock feel, right? A little bit of a emotional connection with it. And I think the story of this album is there are some tranquil parts of this mixed with just full out the equivalent of maybe not shredding on the guitar, but in the jazz context what shredding on the guitar is. There's a very impressive array of drumming. There's the traditional, you know, hi-hat drumming at different times, or jazz drumming, the open hand style, but then there's also in the front, you know, pounding drums that are sometimes keeping up with the sax, sometimes themselves demanding attention, with, you know, a two-hand approach, heavy on the toms and stuff like that. So there's a lot of interesting things going on drumming here. And I like the juxtaposition of the sax and the guitar. And I like the part, mm-hmm. the point that it, you know, throughout the different songs, sometimes they're both going tranquil, sometimes they're both going all in. But sort of the bigger thing is at different times, one of the pieces is going really strong while the other is silent or playing the secondary role in it, which I love the complementary sounds of the sax and the guitar on this album.
Mm-hmm.
This really appealed to my palate. You're right, Josh. I do think this is where like a guy like Jimi Hendrix would have gone. And I think it was what Miles Davis was doing in the beginning of the 70s too, when he sort of, you know, wanted to become the rock star element of it. But make no mistake, there would definitely be people that would tell you that this is not jazz, right? It's too avant-garde for them, and it's rock music. And I think the fact that it blurs those lines so well is what really appeals to me about it. And I can absolutely see why this sound was really catching people's attention at the beginning of the 90s, because it had enough jazz to feel like a retro jazz to the 60s and early 70s, but also it felt fresh and vibrant compared. At times, Pharoah Sanders, it was interesting to hear him play so frantically, because the album we covered from him, it was almost meditative, just one track, meditative. It did have moments of intensity, but it was intense in a different way. You're right, Matt, the biggest, I think, comparative point to this is the Dolphy Out to Lunch album, but also when Coltrane really let loose a couple times, that would be there. It didn't line up as much with people like, you know, Charles Mingus and stuff, even though I know he gets loose. The albums we covered, it didn't really line up with it. It does also share quite a bit in common with that transitionary period of Miles Davis. And it makes sense because he's playing in, well, when I say transition, you have multiple transitions. The one in the late 60s, early 70s is probably the one I should clarify. But yeah, I'm not going to say pleasantly surprised, because I had no idea what I was expecting. I did do a little homework enough to know that this was going to be a jazz album, but much like you guys, I was not processing that the leader of a jazz group could be a guitar player. I don't know why. As you listen to it, it makes total sense. But yeah, thumbs up. And it passed the test where I was curious enough that I wanted to hear what the late 80s stuff sounded like, and I wanted to hear what like his earlier stuff, you know, the especially late 60s stuff when he was in between, like in that ecosystem of all of these great jazz musicians, and I wanted to see how he evolved. And each of the albums, like a good jazz musician, is sort of a reinvention of where he's coming from. And so when he recorded this, you know, he passed away at 54 in 1994. So he would have been 51 when he was recording this. So a little bit later in life.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's sad because this is a promising direction that I could see, like, liking more albums if he had had more in the 90s.
Yeah, it's definitely one of those things that you wonder if he would have surfaced right in mainstream music a little bit more, because I think all of us are responding to it being from the era, because there was a certain magic to, you know, what he had at this point in time that kind of felt classic, but also felt like 1991 in a new evolution, like jazz for our era, kind of. So
yeah.
So thumbs up for me.
Yeah, good stuff.